Despite being extremely influential in the story, at no point do we get to see Paimon in a flesh or apparition form, nor do we hear it speak direct dialogue. Instead, everything about Paimon is communicated indirectly. One of the things I like about that is the fact that Paimon comes from another dimension. He doesn't come from our world, so to have him speak our words wouldn't quite work. He communicates through subtle plot cues, sensory metaphors, and through the behaviour of mortal characters in the moments when they are spiritually possessed. But even then, when he's possessing somebody, he still doesn't speak dialogue. That is, unless he's lying, as in the seance scenes. And we know that Annie is possessed in scenes near the end of the movie because she performs physical feats that a mortal human could never do. But there's also a question of whether Paimon engages in more discreet forms of possession, whether some of the eccentric behaviours of the central characters are actually Paimon's doing. There are also issues of whether Paimon can possess or physically control multiple subjects at once, and there's the question of what he gets up to when he is free-floating and not possessing mortal subjects. From what I can tell, all of these questions and more can be quite reliably answered by a careful breakdown of the film, scene by scene. And I found that a close reading of the film's script provides even more definition to the otherwise invisible Paimon character. But first I want to outline some of the general information on real-world myths about this demon, whose name comes in two spellings, Paimon and Paymon. My first source of reference on this is an old witchcraft spellbook called The Lesser Key of Solomon. This book goes back centuries in various editions, and apparently it's a 17th century compilation of Latin texts from various sources that in turn date back centuries earlier than that. The Lesser Key of Solomon featured descriptions of 72 demons, including Paimon. And it even has the original Paimon symbol or emblem, although it's slightly different to the one we see in Hereditary. It has four curl features at the top instead of three as seen in the film. Portions of the Lesser Key of Solomon were in turn adapted and revised by other occult authors since, including Aleister Crowley, and we'll refer to his depictions of Paimon shortly. Some occult sources online today say that the demons listed in the Lesser Key of Solomon were first published in a book called Pseudomonarchia Daemonum. In Joseph H. Peterson's year 2000 English translation of that book can be found a decent-sized chunk of text about the Paimon demon. There are lots of noteworthy points in this text, but first I'll just clear up a confusing word. The creature Paimon rides on is called a dromedary, which is just another word for camel. The crown and the feminine appearance of Paimon, which is present in the movie in the text that Annie reads, those details are in the 1577 description. Paimon's ability to convey upon the conjurers knowledge about science, etc., that's present in the text as well, along with the specific phrases secret things and good familiars.
Give us your knowledge of all secret things. Bring us honour, wealth and good familiars.
The text also says that Paimon binds people who resist him and binds them to the conjurer. And this is spoken of in similar terms in Hereditary.
Bind all men to our will, as we have bound ourselves for now and ever to yours.
This text says that Paimon must be conjured from the northwest because that's where his house is. In Hereditary, the triangle in Grandma Ellen's bedroom appears to be pointed to the northwest, and the script confirms this. But that issue of Paimon having his own house, I think, fits with the treehouse in Hereditary, basically representing Paimon's supernatural home. Although it's actually positioned southeast of the family house in the film, and that might have been a necessary aspect of the exterior filming location. However, the interior sets of the house were designed specifically according to what Ariaster wanted, and they do not match up with the exterior of the house. I did that in a separate video, explaining how all the various rooms and hallways and stuff in the house, there's too much house in there to fit in what we see from outside, and the actual logistics of the shape of the house are very different to what we see inside. All the shots that we see inside the house in this movie are studio sets. And so, Charlie's treehouse parallel bedroom is in the northwest of the house. Charlie's bedroom is shaped very similar to the treehouse. The text here says that the conjurer should call upon Paimon without fear. In the fictional text in the movie, it says that Paimon will typically possess the most vulnerable or afraid person who is present. That point is crucial to understanding the movie's ending. The text says that Paimon may require sacrifices, and we certainly get plenty of that in the film. Oh, and a very important point is that the text begins by saying Paimon is more obedient to Lucifer than the other kings of hell. And from this, we might assume that he is the most evil of those kings. However, there are some features of Paimon which are in this text, but not in the Hereditary film. One of them is that when he appears, he's supposed to have a sort of musical band that accompanies him. You know, like Robin Hood and his minstrels in Monty Python and the Holy Grail. The text says that Paimon only imparts his knowledge after he tests the conjurer with a general knowledge question of his own. That's not in the film overtly, but it seems to be alluded to in some of the partially readable text in Ellen's book. This text says that Paimon is followed by 200 legions, and a legion of hell is basically an army of lesser demons. Typically, a legion of soldiers refers to several thousand. The text does say that Paimon can be conjured alone, but that if he is, he will be followed by two other demons under his command, Bebal and Abalam, but these aren't present in the film. By the way, this book had Paimon listed as one of the nine kings of hell, but this is mismatched in Hereditary.
You are Paimon, one of the eight kings of hell.
Another occult book is called the Liber Officium Spiritum, which translates as the Offices of Spirits. This book was apparently one of the sources from which the aforementioned Pseudo-Monarchia Daemonum acquired its descriptions. However, the Offices of Spirits book, according to this translation, only has four kings of hell, with Paimon being associated with the West, not the Northwest. Based upon these differences, I doubt that Ari Aster had based his Paimon character on the Offices of Spirits book. His version is more closely matched by the Pseudo-Monarchia Daemonum text. But there are other sources and adaptations of this 1577 book that are much more recent, with additional descriptions and drawings which seem to have influenced Astor's movie version of the character. So our next reference is Grimoire, the Book of the Goetia of Solomon the King. By the way, if I'm pronouncing these wrong, it's because I'm not an occult expert. This was from 1904, and it was written and compiled by the infamous occultist Aleister Crowley. And things get a bit awkward with this book because I've found two online translated versions which have some significant differences. There's this version at archive.org, and on the cover it says that the text was translated by a dead hand, whoever the hell that is. But this translation found at thei.eu shows an illustrated version of the text with the translation citation going to two very human sounding authors rather than a dead hand. On page 31 of the Goetia is a detailed description of Paimon, and the description is mostly the same as in the Pseudo-Monarchia Daemonum text, but the translation this time is into plain modern English instead of the unfamiliar grammatical structure and Latin combination of the Daemonum text. But there is an additional facet in the Goetia book that's missing from the Daemonum version. It says, quote, "His character is this which must be worn as a layman before thee," end quote. A layman, L-A-M-E-N, basically means a magic pendant. These we see worn by characters in Hereditary. And on that basis, it seems that writer-director of Hereditary, Ari Aster, is more likely to have based his Paimon character upon the Aleister Crowley book rather than the older text that I've outlined. And Crowley's Grimoire book also includes drawings of Paimon. Here he is on his camel, not unlike the picture that we see in Hereditary. This picture accompanies the actual text about Paimon. He has the crown, but doesn't have the weird staff that's seen in the film, and he doesn't carry severed heads about with him. We also see the same picture of Paimon on the cover of Crowley's book, along with lots of other demons, and the book cites that these drawings are from an 1863 book called Dictionnaire Infernal. A PDF book of Dictionnaire Infernal is available online. Here it is in Latin, and on page 531, this time with the P-A-Y-M-O-N spelling in the text, and it is the same drawing of Paimon that we see in Crowley's book. This 1863 drawing is the earliest visual depiction of Paimon that I've been able to find. Note that the sigil or symbol for Paimon is not present with this picture. It might be elsewhere in the 700 plus page text though. Being that it's all in Latin, I haven't bothered going through it all page by page. Now there are loads of interesting demons in these various occult books that I've cited. Crowley's book, The Goetia, is full of them, and any one of them could have been used as the basis of a horror story. There's Baal. This demon can turn invisible and can appear as a cat, a toad, or a man, or can appear as a combination of all three creatures in one. Person appears as a man with a lion head riding a bear with a wicked serpent in his hand. That would make one hell of an image in a movie, wouldn't it? There's Astaroth, whose breath can kill the conjurer, so the conjurer must wear a special ring to defend against it. Ferfer can create lightning and storms and never speaks the truth unless compelled by the conjurer. There's 72 of these lunatic demons to choose from, so why would Ariaster pick Paimon? Well, I suspect the answer is quite simply because at the very beginning of the Goetia book is a full-page sketch drawn by Aleister Crowley himself in his childishly crude style. It's a self-portrait of Crowley conjuring none other than Paimon. And from what I can tell, the text and images of the Goetia book match up with Astor's film version of Paimon more than any other occult book that I've been able to find. Crowley's book, however, certainly wasn't Ariaster's only source, because the various occult words that are written on the walls of the house in the film, those aren't from the Goetia book, they're from other sources, but we'll explore those words and their origins much later in this video. Oh, something important about Paimon is that camel he rides. This almost certainly ties him historically to the Middle East, just as the Pazuzu demon in The Exorcist also came from the Middle East. But in ancient Eastern texts, they weren't called demons, they were genies. They could be conjured to do the bidding of man. A lot of Western occultism has Middle East origins, and so it seems a lot of genie folklore was transformed into what we now call demons, who can also be conjured, like genies. Undoubtedly, writer-director Ari Aster had come across some of these Paimon writings, hence the demon is named as such in the film. And undoubtedly some of the finer details are based on those researched writings too. But it's only a loose basis. Some facets of Paimon writings are missing from Aster's film version of the character. Even the sigil or symbol for Paimon is changed slightly in the movie. Like I said, occult writings have four curls at the top on the Paimon symbol, and Hereditary's only has three curls. Sure, Aster may have made that specific change so as not to annoy real-world occultists who might have a reverence for their perceived Paimon demon. But it seems to me that the changing of the sigil to three curls gives the subliminal impression of the number 666, the number of the beast. If Aster did that on purpose, then it was a very clever move. But my general point here is that Aster has changed the Paimon character for the purposes of his story. For example, I've found no references in occult writings to Paimon having a preoccupation with decapitation. In other words, we can't just rely on occult writings for our understanding of Paimon. The film has its own logic for the character.